everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we're making applesauce. Yesterday it snowed, so now it's time to get ready for winter. According to our arborists and the place where we usually get our apples, which is Country Delight Bass's Farm, the apple crop this year was really confusing. First, because of our late spring, the apples didn't start blossoming out until late, and then it was so wet that the whole crop was pushed back. Last week when we went to get our apples, they said they were scrambling to pick any apple that was ready because if they didn't do it before it snowed and got too cold, all the apples on the trees would be ruined. Hopefully they got them. So today we're going to be using some of those apples. We found out a couple years ago that it's best to use seconds. Seconds mean that these apples are not perfect. They're not the kind of apple that you would find on the store shelf because they have little blemishes. These happen to be sugar, like we call them sugar kisses, because some of the sugar has escaped from there, but not enough to change anything. They just aren't pretty. The people at Bass's told us that it's best to use a variety of apples when you're making applesauce. That way you get a mingling of flavors, some sweet, some more tart, some have deeper flavors, and some are sweeter. So when we buy our apples from them, we get bags of seconds. So there's a whole variety of apples that are in this bag. Lately, I've been using lemon oil to rinse my fruits and vegetables. Now you might say, well, why use that? You're going to be cooking them. I don't know how many people have touched this apple besides myself. I don't know what bird might have been flying over them. I know that there's been pesticides used on them. So using a little bit of lemon oil helps clean all of that off. So I'm just going to put in maybe 5 drops, 6 drops, and let it mingle in there with the water. I have a little bit, it's like a lukewarm water. It's not cold, it's not hot. And then I'm just gonna put all of my apples in there and let them soak for just a few minutes. Then I'm gonna thoroughly rinse them off, and then I'll start cutting them up.
Didn't they say you shouldn't put all your apples in the same sink?
No, that was a basket and it was eggs.
Oh.
You have fractured quotations that you're using.
Boy, I can smell that lemon.
That lemon is very powerful.
Pungent.
Yes.
Holy cow.
So now you know.
That was just 6 drops?
It's strong. Yes, that's just 6 drops.
Now is that an essential oil?
Yes, it is. It's concentrated and it's a very pure oil. So this is 2 pounds of apples. So I'm just going to roll them around in here.
Clears my sinuses.
In the past, I've just rinsed them off. So this is just a little bit extra that I'm doing. And what I like to do is I like to kind of just rub them a little bit, especially down in here, even though I'm going to cut most of that off because I figure that's where things will settle. The pesticide will settle in there. Any snow, or it's not snow, any rain, any dust that was in the air, maybe fire smoke from out west or from Canada, those will all be rinsed off. And it just makes for a cleaner, fresher vegetable or fruit and vegetable if you're doing your vegetables. I do this when I buy things in the store too, because who knows how many people have touched those vegetables in the store. How many miles it's come. We know at least that these apples came from, what, 3 miles away, 4 miles away?
Oh, I'd say more like
more
10.
Than that? Okay. Yeah. Now that they're all soaked and ready to go, I'm just rinsing them off. Not that lemon is going to affect the flavor at all, but it might be kind of interesting if it did, but I don't think it will. When I used to make applesauce with my mother, she always used something called a foley mill, and I'm thinking, what in the heck is a foley mill? Well, it was a food grinder that was made by the Foley Company, like Axel Foley from Beverly Hills Cop. What is that? All right, so it's a pan with these very fine holes in the bottom.
Great.
And each of the holes, yes, like a sandpaper, like a grater. Then this goes on top. This is your masher that you swirl around. And as the apples work their way through, you end up with a sauce rather than just clumps of apples. This is the cleaner that goes on the bottom. Okay, so you just
scrapes off.
Right. It helps move the applesauce from the inside of the pan to the big pan that you want to put it in. Okay. I just learned by reading what's written on this little paddle here that if you're doing, let's say you wanted to make jam from plums or cherries and they have seeds in them, then it says don't put this part on. Just let it be freer and then you can move it around because you actually push down on this paddle as you turn it to get the bulk of the fruit out. Never knew that before. This is now, it doesn't say Foley on it anymore, so obviously the patent probably has run out and now it's just called a food mill. Some recipes say just cook your apples. They have you take the skin off, take out all of the core of the apple, and then you just mash it with a potato masher. Somehow I feel that some of the flavor comes from the skin and right under the skin. So if you cook it with the skin on and then run it through the mill, you're getting the most flavor. The next step is going to be the apples. All right, so I've got my big pan, and I'm using my big, big pan. This is my hugest pan. And I've put about an inch of water in the bottom. And that's because as the apples first start to steam in there and break down, there's no juice coming out of them yet, and you don't want them to burn and stick onto the bottom of the pan. If after you've cooked them and you just feel like your applesauce is too juicy, you can always drain off some of that apple juice and save it and filter it and drink it yourself as apple juice. Raw apple juice. Well, not raw, but untouched by human hands. Okay, so my mother always did this. She quartered the apples. She cut out the part where the stem is, where everything can just kind of hide in there. And then, depending on the size of the apple, just cut it in two. I'm not taking out the core. I would take off any blemish that might be on there. But I just don't like this part. Because you see this. This is where the stem was. And even though it's been rinsed and even though it's been washed, there's still stuff in there. I don't want that stuff in my applesauce. It's starting to smell wonderful already. Now this is 2 bags worth. That's for about 40 apples. And that's what each bag has, 20 apples in it. And we did 2 bags. And this is all of the ends that I've taken off. The stem end and the blossom end down here. These will go in the compost, and these now have started cooking, and now I'm pretty much stuck in the kitchen for a while because every now and again I've got to stir it to make sure that they're all getting some of the heat and that nobody's sticking on the bottom. I can put the cover on, which I will, because that'll help the steam get to everybody, but for right now, just me and my large spoon.
And then how long does it take?
Oh, it's going to take a while. I don't know. I can't remember how long. Maybe an hour. Could be more. But with the cover on, it'll be even better. You're going to start off high, and then as they start to mush down, then you can turn it kind of to a medium. But you still need to be here to stir. stir, stir. I feel like a witch stirring my brew. They're almost done. They're just when you try to push them against the side of the pan, if you have some resistance, then you know they're not done yet. So we have a little bit ways to go, but it's coming along nicely.
It smells delicious.
Doesn't it? I could smell it before I even opened the door when I came in. I think we're almost ready. Just one last check. Yep. Pass my wall squishing test. That means we're ready. So I'm going to turn it off. Now this is where, if you have a helper, you can put them to work.
Uh-huh.
It's doing the Foley mill part. It's the grinding up.
Well, you're going to have to show me how it's done.
Oh, you've forgotten, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. What you want to do is kind of line your pans up so you're not dribbling all over everywhere. I have a clean pan underneath. Obviously, that will not be big enough for all of this, but I have other pans. I'm going to move some of these apples into the Foley mill. Now, to me, this is not too juicy, so I am not going to be taking off any of the liquid.
Smells delicious.
Yes, it does. Okay. Now it's time to do the milling, if you want to call it that. So you move it clockwise, and you're pressing down. Often, frequently, you have to go backwards to clear off all those little holes that are allowing the applesauce to go down below. So it's not hard work, it just takes a while. And this is where all the seeds, all the skin, all of those little shells that are inside that hold the seeds in place, those are all then filtered out of here because they won't go down the little holes, and that way you have pure applesauce underneath.
Now what do you do with the slurry that's left?
The seeds and the skin?
Uh-huh.
Compost.
Okay.
Okay, so you do it until you feel that most of the apple has been mashed up.
Can you just lift this up just a little bit?
I was just going to do that after I got this part done.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so I would say that's pretty much ready. Okay, so that's what it looks like. Get a clean spoon and see what it looks like.
Nice consistency.
Mm-hmm. So then this gets dumped, and then you start all over again with a new batch that has to be milled. All the Foley milling is done. This is how it turned out. It's beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Now I'm going to put it all in this clean pan. Everything's been washed now so that there's no little residues of seeds or skin or anything. So I'm just going to dump these two pans into one. Make sure all of it is out. Don't want to miss any goodness. And then once they're all together in one pan, then we'll do our adding of sugar or whatever else we're going to put in here. And that's when I need a taster. I wonder who that'll be.
Is it somebody I know?
I think it is.
So this is 40 apples worth?
This is 40 apples. Yep, two bags. And we bought 6 bags. So we're going to eat one bag. We made 2 bags into applesauce, and then I'm going to dry some and...
Dehydrate?
Yes.
Okay.
All right. Now, these are done. Now comes the adding of the sugar. Put it over here. The salt. And a little bit of honey. Now you may want to say, well, why are you putting salt in there? Salt and vanilla enhance the flavors of whatever you're cooking. So if you're cooking meat and potatoes and things, usually it's salt that you're going to be adding. If you're doing baked goods, it's vanilla that you're adding. This is some vanilla that we made ourselves with vanilla beans and vodka. Smells really good. And this is what it looked like. We set this in the dark closet, put the vanilla beans in there, filled it up with vodka, and it had to sit in there for at least a month. This is much older than that. It was at the very, very bottom, so there was a lot of little pieces. So I strained it through a coffee filter and cleared it out, but it smells really good. All right, now there are recipes that I have read that add nothing to the applesauce. They don't add sugar, they don't add salt. Some of them add lemon juice, some of them add vinegar. I'm not going that far. Some of them add cinnamon. I did that one year, but I just like, if you want cinnamon, you can add it afterward, but you don't want a whole batch of it. So for this amount of applesauce, I could use a spoon. This is the old-fashioned way. I'll pretend this is my mother. Okay, I'm going to add about a teaspoon, and this is sea salt. Okay. Then I'm going to add about a teaspoon of vanilla, give or take.
You're kind of like a French cook.
I am, aren't I?
Pinch of this.
Mm-hmm.
Dollop of that.
Okay, then I'm going to start with a cup of sugar, which I'm sure is not going to be enough for my husband's palate, but we'll start with a cup.
Well, Mary Poppins only wants you to use a spoonful.
I hope you have your tasting spoon ready.
I don't. I didn't know you were going to have me do that.
Of course, that's your job. That's why it's so nice to have other people in the house when you're cooking, because then you have another palate to tell you whether you've added the right amount of this and the right amount of that. Okay, here you go. Try it. Now, I have not added any honey yet, so we will see what happens. How did it taste?
Bland.
Bland. Was there enough sugar in there? Is it sweet enough?
No.
Somehow I knew you'd say that. Okay, now I'm going to add a squirt of honey. Now, depending on whether you like honey or not, that's how much you add or don't add. Okay, so...
You could put your finger in there, honey.
That amount, nope. And then I'm going to add... I'll fill it to a cup, but we may not add all that right away. All right. Do you think it needs a little more salt?
I think so.
A little more vanilla?
Yeah. Something to bring out the... And definitely more vanilla.
Okay.
It's kind of like a witch's brew on Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
Except it's a good brew.
Okay, I measured that one. Now, I do have this on at a low heat. Doesn't need to be on, but when I start to process it, it helps if it's already warmed up and it won't take so long. All right, clean spoon.
I don't need as much for each testing, so.
All right. Here you go.
Oh, that's getting better.
I think you need to test it.
Because it's still... My spoon is small.
Well, you have a small mouth.
It tastes very apple-y. Needs a little more sugar and a little salt. The rest of the sugar. Maybe some more honey.
What? Did you call me?
I like honey, so...
Well, I'm glad you like me.
I do. Might as well throw the rest of this in.
Go ahead. Go for it.
I could have drunk that. That was just vanilla flavored vodka. Bring your little taster over here.
It's getting there.
What do you mean getting there?
What?
Test it. How much more can it get?
Try it. See, it needs something.
Does it need a little lemon juice, maybe?
Could be.
Okay, let me squeeze a lemon. Okay, we'll try a little bit of lemon juice. Now, each year, you're going to have a different variety of apple flavors, and depending on the year and the weather, I'm guessing that each batch is going to be a little bit different.
Oh, well.
So, I'm just going to add maybe a teaspoon. It's more like 2 teaspoons.
And this will add a little tang?
It will.
Definitely getting better. Yep. Now that tastes like applesauce. Mm. That is good.
More lemon juice?
I think so. Just a little. But it's really close.
A little bit more sugar.
So how much sugar would you say you used so far?
2 cups, was it? And no, because I think I only filled them this far up.
Okay.
And this is 1/2 cup.
And how long does it take for the sugar to fully dissolve?
It's pretty much done. It's almost instant because this is warm. So it doesn't take long at all.
Hmm.
Okay, this is our last clean spoon before I have to do some washing here. Might be getting a little warmer.
Hmm.
Is that it?
I think that's it.
I'll use your spoon. I think so.
Does that mean I can't test anymore?
You could have a little bowl of it.
I'll wait.
Good boy. We just wanted to recap about what we've actually added to this. So this is 40 apples, about 2.5 cups of sugar, about 3 tablespoons of honey, 2 teaspoons of salt, and the juice of 1 lemon. And I think we got it.
Well, my taste buds.
And your taste buds, yes. Right. Now, I'm going to be filling the jars so they can be processed. Now, I use a steaming processor rather than a water bath processor. Different verdicts out on steaming. I have never had a problem with steaming. You only use this much water instead of a whole pan full of water. I've never had one bad experience with any of the food that I have processed this way. To me, it's faster, it saves water.
I noticed they don't make that unit anymore.
No. At least not that we've seen online. What's going to happen then is I'm going to be moving my big container over to here, and then I'm going to be filling these jars. I can do 7 at a time in my processor. So these
steamer?
Yes, in my steaming processor. So these jars have been washed and they've been sterilized. So I'm going to putting my applesauce right here. Now, depending on the apples you use, it'll depend on what the flavor is like, obviously. It'll also determine what color your applesauce is. If you like a redder applesauce, then you use more reddish apples. If you like a more tart applesauce, you use apples like Macintosh or Granny Smith. We tend to like a sweeter applesauce. And like I said before, we found that if you use a mixture of apples, you get a really good flavor. Okay, so I fill this up to just below that line. You want to have room in there for bubbling that takes place. Will we make it? Will it make 7 quarts? It'll be close. Ta-da!
When you're good, you're good.
The lids have rubber. The rubber has to be warmed up a little bit before you put it on so that you have a good seal.
So you've heated up this water.
I've heated the water. I'm putting these in.
Didn't I buy you a rack?
You did, but to me it uses too much water. So I'll do it the way my mother did. A pan of water. Now the final step is to clean off the very top. This, if there's going to be a failure, it's because the top hasn't been cleaned off well enough.
Or the glass is chipped.
Yes. So as you're rubbing your clean towel around, you're feeling for any chips. Although hopefully you've done that before while you were washing them so you're not wasting time. So you put it on there and you try not to move it around too much. And then you're going to put your ring on and you're just going to give it a little tightening. Not as tight as you can possibly go and not loose. So it's not loose here. It's just perfect. Okay, and then this goes into the processor. And that's already warming up so that it doesn't take as long because it all has to be in there for, I believe, 35 minutes, but I will be checking that to make sure I get my time right. Okay, cleaning it off. Putting the lid on, putting the ring on. Snug. Cover goes on. Now you see there's this tiny little hole here. It says caution. Once I get this going, and I'm going to start it at kind of a medium-high temperature, once it gets going, the steam plume has to come out 8 inches before you start timing. I think that's the key thing. If you don't wait until it's out far enough, it doesn't mean it's warm enough or hot enough to do its job. So I have to stay in the kitchen and keep my eye on this. Once it gets to 8 inches out, I turn it down just a little bit and I set my timer. And I looked in the book that comes with this processor, and it's 20 minutes that it has to steam. And then when it's done, you turn it off, you let it sit for 5 minutes, and then you take the cover off and carefully remove them and put them in a place where there is no breeze so that they can cool without any airflow. Right.
Would that be the same time element for tomatoes and canning
no,
other things?
Everything has its own time. So when you get the book, let me get the book over here. You get a chart. And we've checked and they don't seem to have these anymore. At least maybe they ran out of them or something and you can find them. But there's your chart. So if you were doing sliced apples, that's 20 minutes. If you're doing, find something that's different. Peaches, 30 minutes. Pears, 30 minutes. Pineapple, 30. Plums, 25. Tomatoes, 45. Because I'm doing quarts. So everything has its own length of time that it has to steam. Now, it sounds like it's going to get ready to steam, but it isn't. This takes quite a while. I shouldn't say quite a while. It takes several minutes for it to get going enough to get 8 inches of plume coming out. And you'll see it when it comes out. And that's when you start timing. One of the side effects of making applesauce or anything that you're making, that includes turkey dinners or whatever, is you have cleanup to do afterward. Now, I have already washed this pan 3 times. Once when I got it out of the front porch to start it. Once when I had it and I was just boiling or getting the apples ready, and now I'm going to wash it again after making the applesauce. But then there's these 2 pans where I have to move the applesauce
from the foley
before I put it. Yes. And then there's this. Somebody's been tasting a lot.
Well, they said a spoonful of applesauce.
So this is something that, you know, you have to take the time. Now, when I was reading a recipe, it said the total amount of time it should take to make applesauce is 45 minutes. And I just laughed. Of course, they were just making a small batch. And that's something you could do. If you don't want to go through this whole process, but you just have a taste for applesauce, go to the store, buy some apples. Probably not the hard kind of apples like a Delicious, Red Delicious, or Golden Delicious. Those are too hard. Something more like a McIntosh or a Granny Smith.
How about Honeycrisp?
Honeycrisp, probably not.
Too hard?
Jonathan would work, a Jonna Gold. Yeah, that other would be too crisp. Peel them off, cut them up a little bit, put them in a saucepan, heat them up until they're mushy, and then you can use your potato mash and just mash them up and then season them the way you want them. But if you're going to do a batch and you want it to last all winter, until you eat it all, then you have to go through a bigger process.
Well, you're going to clean all of this, and now you're going to repeat the entire process
yes,
all over again.
Because we've decided I should make another batch, so
well,
I shall.
I'll go buy you more apples.
Of course you will. You just want to do some more tasting.
Well, yeah, duh.
You can see how far this plume is coming out. So I can turn it down a little bit now so that it's more of a controlled plume, so I can hear it processing in there. And I'm now going to set the timer for 20 minutes. Then when 20 minutes is done, I turn it off, and then I let it rest for 5 minutes before I take the cover off. There's the beep. It's been 20 minutes. I've turned it off, set the timer for 5 more minutes, and when that's done, then I can take the cover off and move them to the cooling spot. The moment of truth. Cover comes off. Tilt it away so you don't get burned by the steam. And then I use my handy dandy grippers here. And I move it to my cooling area. Now there's water on the top. Not worrying about that, that will evaporate. The less you can jar these, the better. So you don't want to disturb them at all while they're cooling. I'm just going to leave this one here, I think.
I heard one pop already.
Yes, and that's what they'll do. What happens is this middle part, while it's up now, will suck down as they cool, and then you know they're done. This one's done. This one's done. This one looks like it's done. This one is. Did I say that one?
This one has a little.
Yep, these still have a little puff on it, and that one looks like it's done also. Day two, batch two. I've got my apples washed, cored, and now cooked. And I'm ready to put them through the folding mill. So it'll be a whole new batch.
You're going to be making applesauce all week.
You never know. If you enjoyed this video, please give us a thumbs up. We hope you'll enjoy tasting your own applesauce when you make it also. And if you'd like to leave a comment or a question, please do that too. We love hearing from you. To become a Garden Family member, please just subscribe right there at that orange button. And finally, happy Halloween. I think it's finally here now.
Well,
on my second batch, almost ready to process.
Connect with us on YouTube.